Good morning. Thank you for joining us online this morning. We're grateful that you are able to, and that we can sing together this morning, that we can pray together, that we can be in the Word together, even though physically we are apart. We know that spiritually that we're thinking of each other. We are together. We are united as a church. And distance does not keep us from those things. And so we pray that this morning would encourage you and challenge you as we finish up our Rooted series. It's been very beneficial these past couple of months as we've looked through very specific things and how to be grounded in the Word and prepared for the future. And we pray that that it has done that indeed in your life. Let's pray this morning before we continue any further, though. Father, we are so grateful for your love for us and the grace that you show us each and every day. And as we open our eyes, and as you open them, we see the aspects of those things in a greater capacity and the even most minute of ways throughout our day. And we pray that as we ourselves have witnessed and experienced those facets of your character in our own lives, that we ourselves would be quick to imitate those characteristics with those around us. Especially in a world that is quick to anger, quick to hate, quick to unrighteousness, that we would be quick to focus again on your character and to imitate those things that you have emulated for us. Father, we pray that you give us strength as we do that, and that we can truly be salt and light in the world around us that is in desperate need of hope and of truth. Find us faithful in being in your Word, simply so that we can share those things, as well as faithful in loving the church, loving those around us, for all you've called us to that. And we recognize that in the days to come, that certain aspects of things that we do as a church, as believers, will likely get harder. And so, as we go through those trying times together, may we lean upon one another. May you encourage us through them. May you comfort us, we pray. Use the time this morning, Lord, to challenge us and encourage us from your Word. As we sing these songs, may they remind us once more of passages of Scripture and of facets of your character that will just help us in our own walk of faith. Guide us, we pray, in your heavenly name. Amen.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, my Savior, all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior, all the day long. Submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, ring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love.
Thank you. my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease.
Persecuted church today, I want to look at the country of India. There is a video that accompanies this, which we're not able to show online. There's no way to connect that, but we're going to provide the link on the screen. In fact, that'll be on the display right now. You can pause the video if you need to for a moment to write that link down to visit it later. Otherwise, you can just simply go to Open Doors USA and put that in a Google search and go to the stories section on their website, and it should be the first or second story on there. But we want to focus on the country of India today. It is within the top 10 persecuted countries of the world presently. And the current ruling party that has took power in 2014, since they took power, incidents against Christians have increased, particularly by Hindu radicals who attack them. The view of Hindu nationalists is that to be Indian is to be Hindu. And so to be anything else really spits in the face, if you will, at their nationalism and motivates, while it's not the proper action, of course, it does motivate the actions that they are taking presently. And so converts to Christianity from Hindu backgrounds in particular experience some of the most harshest persecution within that country. Recently, our partners in India shared shocking footage of a frenzied mob of 2,000 people attacking 80 Christians. And if it were not for the police that were on the scene at that particular moment in time, the Christians themselves likely would have been physically harmed. They escaped that, but are unable to return back to their homes, which were severely damaged in those attacks. Open Doors writes that the persecution began with a village meeting when 14 believers were summoned by their fellow villagers. Their community accused them of following a foreign religion. And a few days after the meeting, villagers came together. Many of them were drunk, carrying bamboo rods and homemade weapons with one purpose, to attack Christians' homes and belongings. And they shouted Hindu slogans and then began to destroy the homes. And this attack went on, or those attacks went on, for 2 days. This is what Christian persecution looks like in many parts of India today. It's often mob-fueled and violent. And you can see it from that video if you take a moment to look at that. Villagers specifically targeted the roofs of houses, exposing those particular structures then to the heavy monsoon rains that are coming. A local Christian leader explained villagers have purposely damaged the roofs of the houses so that their belongings become wet in the rainwater. Police were called, however, as is often the parts in India, they did nothing to intervene in the destruction. They stood by and watched the crowd and as they shouted things like, "Since you become Christians, our gods are angry with us. They don't listen to us anymore." In certain parts of India, persecutors often attack with impunity, often leading to more and greater violence against minorities. As I said earlier, had there been no police at all, they remarked that the Christians themselves would have suffered physical harm. Most of them have not returned home, but are strong in their faith. "If I leave Christ, I will die," one victim said. "It is only Jesus who brings healing. It's better to die for him. Only he is the truth. Yes, we are scared, but only a little. God is with us." What a testimony of faith that is to us in our own country and the things that we face. In addition to that, there's been numerous other attacks throughout 2019, last year, as church buildings were torn down in January of 2019. A tribal man was attacked with swords and sickles and iron sticks in April of 2019. He was actually killed by a crowd of Hindu radical cow protectors on suspicion of having slaughtered an ox, which are, of course, as you know, cows are sacred to Hindus. And then in October of 2019, a Christian birthday celebration was attacked as well. And guests that had gathered there had been stormed by this group of individuals, about 30. Again, this mob mentality have attacked them as well. So these are individuals that we can be praying for. Pray specifically for Christian converts from Hinduism as they face some of the most severe persecution that does take place within the country. Pray for God's power and protection over Christians as they preach the gospel in many places where anti-conversion laws exist. In fact, that is being pushed more and more by the present party to become a national thing and not just regional. And pray for the government leaders, of course. Paul, in second area, as he writes to Timothy, encourages us to do that. Pray that they would change their perspective and create more room for religious freedom. And we think we can pray even further than that, though, as we know the Holy Spirit does amazing work. And we can pray that he himself will work in the hearts and lives of these leaders, softening them to the Word of God and to the gospel, and that they themselves would turn in faith to him. In fact, let's do that right now. Let's pray not only for the Christians, but for the leaders as well. Father, we are disturbed to hear the news of what is taking place with our brothers and sisters around the world. Of course, we are not shocked by this, though. After all, Jesus said, as they persecuted him, indeed, we ourselves should not be shocked by the persecution that comes toward us. And we see that reality taking place today in many parts of the world, particularly though in India, as these Hindu radicals attack our Christian brothers and sisters. And Father, we pray for their strength, physically, emotionally, spiritually, as they face these trials and tribulations in their lives and the persecution. We pray ultimately for those that are attacking them, though, that they themselves would be would see the witness of these believers, that they themselves would be so struck by that and by the work of your Spirit in their lives that they would turn to you in faith, responding to the truth of the gospel and the truth of your word. We know that you desire all people to come to faith, and Father, it is our desire as well that these particular individuals would do that they would turn from their wickedness and that they would turn to you. We pray ultimately for the leaders, though, that as it looks like they are continuing to further these anti-conversion laws and other things that restrict Christian freedoms within this particular country, that you would so motivate them and move within their lives that they would have sympathy on the Christians, that they would change laws. We pray above all, though, that they would change their hearts, that you would do that, and that they would come to faith in you, that they themselves might even join right alongside the believers enduring this same persecution as they've turned to faith in you. That is our prayer above all, that these people would turn in faith to you. May we ourselves, in our own local context, be faithful in sharing that and the truth that can be found and the hope that can be found in Jesus alone. Father, thank you for these brothers and sisters. And we look forward to seeing one day, whether on this earth or in heaven. Thank you for the hope that we have in that. We pray this in your name. Amen.
What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can see
Good morning. Well, we're going to be in Jeremiah chapter 17 today. And if you notice the title, it doesn't say scrub brush, it says scrub bush. So get the words right there. We're going to be concluding our series on Rooted, Grounded in the Word, Prepared for the Future. I hope that if you missed any of this series, that you'll go to our website and watch each of the video sermons. No one knows the future except God, but you know, we can be prepared for future events personally, as a family, as a church. There is a biblical worldview and a mindset, or we could say attitudes as well as behaviors, that God has revealed in His Word, and God wants us to be fully informed and conforming ourselves to His plan regardless of what's happening in the world. Circumstances don't change Him or His Word. Now, before the present Rooted series that Pastor Daniel and I preached, we preached through the book, most of the book of Isaiah. You know, I've been reading and thinking about the Old Testament prophets lately. Our Sunday school pictures and whatever other pictures of the prophets we might have seen have led us to believe these guys are tough, old, grizzled geezers. Emphasis on old. But here's the real story. I ran the numbers and looked rather carefully. Isaiah was married and had at least two sons. His ministry spanned about 55 to 60 years, so he wasn't old until the end. If he served the Lord for that length of time, it's very likely he began in his 20s. Jeremiah was a single man, never married. He served the Lord for 47 years. And I've been in full-time vocational pastoral ministry for a little over 46 years, and I began when I was 26 years old. So I'm guessing that Jeremiah was about my age when he started his work. Ezekiel tells us that he was 30 when he began his ministry, and he served the Lord for at least 22 years, judging from the dates of his first and last prophetic messages. He may have lived longer than that. But let's picture these men in their 30s and 40s and 50s instead of their 70s and 80s. You say, well, so what? What difference does that make? Well, these guys were rooted. Their lives were committed to the Lord, and they called others in Israel to change their ways and live for the Lord the way He wanted them to. These guys were not well received by their countrymen, but they faithfully served the Lord for many years, the long-haul ministries. Which encourages me that it's possible. Today, we desperately need men to be courageous spiritual leaders in their homes, not couch potatoes leaving the spiritual leadership to their wives. We need men to be intentional examples to their children, intentionally teaching them the Word of God. The biblical commitment and love for the Lord that affects people's lives is slipping away rapidly. We are just seeing that just kind of evaporate. We're going to look at Jeremiah 17 this morning, but in order to get to chapter 17, we need to take a quick look at chapter 16. Things were so bad in Israel in Jeremiah's lifetime, God gave him, not us, three directions that made him somewhat of a social misfit in his generation. Number one, he said, don't get married and have a family. In chapter 16, verse 2, he said, people will die from terrible diseases, and they will not be buried. War and starvation will take many others. Jeremiah, you don't want a wife and children to go through those kinds of things. Singleness, though, in that culture and time was not looked upon favorably. Direction number two, he said, don't go to funerals or show sympathy for your people and families when people die. When death occurs, life will be so out of whack. Back in that time, no one will show sympathy to even bury the dead or mourn or bring a meal or a glass of wine to a grieving family. Third direction, don't go to any dinners or parties. Boy, that sounds familiar like today, doesn't it? God's judgment would end the happy singing and laughter in the land. Disease and war and famine has a way of putting the kibosh on emotional happiness. Those three directions were for Jeremiah, not for us. But God told Jeremiah that people would ask him, God, why does God done all these terrible things to them? What did we do to deserve this? Through Jeremiah, God told them, your ancestors served idols and worshiped other gods. And that was a simple answer, wasn't it? But then he added, and you are even worse than your ancestors in chapter 16, verses 11 and 12. That was a rather bleak picture. But what about now in 2020 and beyond? Why dust off the Old Testament, beside the fact that I like the Old Testament, and see what God did back then? How does that affect us now? Well, I'm glad you asked. And I realize I just put words in your mouth, but let me give you four quick reasons why we look at the Old Testament. Number one, our country is doing many of the same things that ancient Israel and other ancient nations did. There's corrupt leadership politically, spiritually, economically. There was social injustice, violence, shedding of innocent blood and child sacrifice back then. It's abortion now. Idolatry, immorality, wealth, material ease. People rejected their creator and redeemer, and they trusted their wealth and alliances with other nations for their security. And this created a spiritual void in people's lives that was filled through false spiritual things. Second reason why we look at the Old Testament, we need to know God's character and his purposes and his methods. The Old Testament demonstrates that God is merciful and gracious and loving and patient, but he is also holy and just. There is a terminal point to God's patience, and then he must judge justly with the consequences that fit the crimes. A few weeks ago, and this is point number three, why we look at the Old Testament, is that there's an important principle in Jeremiah 18. God will spare nations that will repent and turn from wicked ways, but he will judge and destroy nations that turn from him to live in rebellion and wickedness. And then the fourth reason is that we need to know what the prophets told the people in their lifetime, because those same spiritual truths about the true and living God help us not get spun around and disoriented by all the different voices that we hear today telling us various things, much of which is wrong. Let me share a few important spiritual truths and directions from Jeremiah this morning. These truths need to be part of our root structure anchored in God's Word. And the first truth is in Jeremiah 16:19, make a daily personal commitment to trust God. Now, logic is used in computer programs, which I know nothing about. However, I do know about if-then commands. If this is true, then do this. You've probably seen flowcharts with this kind of logic along the way. Jeremiah 16:19 says this. Jeremiah says to God, "Yahweh, Lord, you are my strength, my fortress, my refuge in the day of trouble." And you may be thinking, "Paul, I didn't see any if-then statements there." Well, the if part of it is, if we are in the day of trouble, then we should make God our strength, our fortress, and refuge. Trouble is a very interesting word in Hebrew. The idea is that we are in dire straits. We are in a tight place. We are pressured. We are stressed psychologically and emotionally and spiritually. The Greek word that was used to translate this Old Testament word focuses on pressing or being squeezed. It was the word that was used for squeezing olives or grapes. It was distressing circumstances. And are not people worldwide in distress today, physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually, economically, because of the COVID pandemic, natural disasters, wars, losses of relationships, family, jobs, income, and the list could go on and on. We are pressed. We are squeezed. There is distress. It's this word, trouble. If that's the then, I mean, if the if part of it, what is the then? Jeremiah says, "Lord, you are my strength." This is the then part of the logic. When we are powerless and weak, do we say to God, who is a person we can have a relationship with, "You are my strength"? This is not mere knowledge about God, but knowing Him personally. God is not a seminar or a hospital or a mental health facility. He's not a government program or an organizational entity. He is a person. It says that He is a fortress, which is a place of safety. I've seen fortresses in various countries. These places are built on hills. They are massive. They look strong. They are for protection. The refuge, light, slightly different nuance, was a place to escape to, a run to and in trouble. That's similar, but just slightly different. If we are in days of trouble or uncertainty, there is a safe place, a person, Yahweh God, Jesus. Now, why would we say He is the refuge and strength? Well, very simply, He is the Creator and the Sovereign. He has the authority and the power and the ability to do something about the problem. I also think of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. We know their names. It's Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, their Hebrew names. In Daniel chapter 3, when they are face to face with Nebuchadnezzar, the most powerful king in history, they said to him, "If our God whom we serve exists, He is able to rescue us from the furnace of blazing fire, and He will rescue us, O king, from your power as well. But if He does not, let it be known to you, O king, that we don't serve your gods, and we're not going to take a knee to the golden statue that you've erected." That means pay homage. Okay, I just modernized it a little bit. We are not going to bow down. They understood that God is able, but if He isn't, we go to heaven. That's what they were saying. Now, Jeremiah 16, verses 19 and 20, the second part of 19, here's the alternative, trusting God. The word says Gentiles from around the world would admit their ancestors left us only falsehood because they worshiped worthless idols. And then a rhetorical question. Can people make their own gods? That's not sensible at all. How can a person make a god who's more powerful than he is? They're not real gods at all, God says. People in USA might not worship carved images, but do we not see people trusting other people or institutions or money or government or science or education like they were God to give answers and solve society's problems? We see that all the time. So the question is the true and living God really your strength, your fortress, your refuge? I hope that you make Him so. Second truth that we see in Isaiah 17, I enjoyed this chapter. I read through Jeremiah not too long ago and said, boy, I really need to preach on this chapter. Jeremiah 17, 5 through 8, "You'll either be a scrub bush," not brush, "scrub bush in the desert, or you will be a fruitful tree by a river." Here's what these verses say. This is what the Lord says. Cursed are those who put their trust in mere humans. Secondly, who rely on human strength. And third, who turn their hearts away from Yahweh God. They are like stunted shrubs in the desert with no hope for the future. They will live in a barren wilderness in an uninhabited, salty land. There's one picture of life, isn't it? And I'm sure you can probably make these couple of sentences into, if this is true, then this is the result statement. That's the cause-effect. So those if-then statements cannot just be logic. If this is true, then do this. But they can be cause-effect statements as well. People wonder why their lives are in such a mess. Relationships are damaged. They have anxiety and fear and despair. Well, there's three clues in verse 5. The trust and reliance are in the wrong people, maybe themselves and others. Proverbs 28:26 says, "The one who trusts in his own heart is a fool, but the one who walks in wisdom will escape." And the third clue is that they turn their hearts away from Yahweh, the true and living God. Now, the heart is the emotions, the thoughts, the choices, the conscience. And unbelief, when we turn away from God, when we have that sense of unbelief, this is a huge affront to God because it basically calls him a liar. When people don't believe what he says to be true, that his promises are certain, we're saying he's lying, he's untrustworthy. That's not a good idea. You know, here's an example in the Old Testament as well. Back in Numbers, God, and before this, God promised to bring Israel to a land of milk and honey and give it to them. 12 spies went in to scout out the land, and they brought the report back. This is a great land. Look at the size of the grapes. They're about the size of grapefruits. It took two guys to carry one bunch of grapes. But there are walled cities and giants. We can't do this. We can't take the land. You know, that was calling God, who promised them to give it to them. That was calling him a liar. Did God know about the walled cities and the giants? Of course he did. Well, you can read the rest of the story in the book of Joshua. But I'm also thinking that when God says, "Don't be afraid, for I am with you," and say, "Well, I'll be afraid. I'll worry about this. I'll worry about that," you are calling God a liar. He says, "I will be with you. I will comfort you. I will meet your needs." You know, when we talk about rooted, is it not a choice? Will we depend and trust on ourselves or man's thinking and methodology and worldview? You know, man's view is that we are products of our environment. We are victims of our circumstances. We can better ourselves with hard work and government help and luck. Oh, good luck with that. Or we can trust God. You know, his word works if we humbly obey it. It is like following the manufacturer's directions. You know, picture number 2 in this chapter, not just the bush in the desert. There's a word "but" in the next few verses there. But here's the contrast. Blessed are those who trust in the Lord, who made the Lord their hope and confidence. They are like trees planted by the riverbank with roots that go deep into the water. Such trees are not bothered by the heat or anxious by long months of drought. Well, why is that true? Well, because their roots are deep into the water. Their leaves stay green. They never stop producing fruit. Wow, what a different picture. But you see, trust is a choice. It's a decision. It's not a feeling. I trust you because I know you. I know your track record of dependability. Can we say that about God? Do you have a record of his dependability for you personally? His guidance, his answers to prayer, his provisions? I hope you have those things written down. That's your record of his dependability. That's why you can trust him now and in the future. Because of difficult days is because you've trusted him in the past. What's God's track record with you? Do you remember it? You know, Satan just loves to fog us when we get into trouble, but all of a sudden, all the stuff that God did in the past, that just kind of evaporates in our minds if we don't have it written down. We need to have it written down. You know, roots give stability, but they also are the channels for nourishment for the plant or the tree. Where do we plant our roots? What are our intake sources? You know, that's going to determine our spiritual and emotional and our mental health. In verse 8, it says the heat and no rain would bother a tree unless the roots are by the water source. So we have that if then, the cause and effect. Trusting the Lord will have an effect on our lives. Do you see the two contrasting pictures? There's two locations, there's two results, there's two decisions of who you trust. One results with no hope, the other results in not being worried. One results in fruitlessness, the other results in fruitfulness. Your choice is to be a scrubby bush in a salty desert or a fruitful tree by a constant water source. Doesn't this section sound a little like Psalm 1, where it says, blessed is the man, the woman, the teen, the child, who doesn't hang around the wrong people so as to be influenced by them. You remember the walk, the sit, stand, and the sit? Here is one who delights in the Word of God, meditating on it regularly, day or night. You know, if you're going to meditate or think about the Word of God, you have to hear it, you have to read it, you have to memorize it. You don't get these things by carrying your Bible or putting your hand on your Bible and it just by osmosis goes into your heart and brain. You can't sit it on your table or just have it as an app on your phone or computer. Your familiarity with and relationship and obedience to God is going to have an impact on you as a person. It will impact your relationships, your vocation, your service for God, and your ministry and your service to other people's lives. Now, if we put Psalm 2 next to Psalm 1, which is a good thing because 2 follows 1, doesn't it? Well, why are people in the nations so angry today? Well, that Psalm says they plot against Yahweh and His anointed, the Messiah. People are often in a rage today because they don't like who God is and what He's asking them to do. Think about it. That thing inside each person called a conscience either approves or condemns us. It's built in and cannot easily be shut off. And it registers guilt much of the time. And if people don't know how to get right with God and get rid of guilt, it makes them angry at themselves and everyone around them. What are we seeing today? We are seeing a ton of anger in mobs. Why? It goes really back to being angry with God and what He's asking. Remember, He's the one that has the right to ask of us to worship Him alone and do what He says. He is the Creator, and He can ask that. And people are angry. Third truth that we want to get is out of this passage in verse 9 and 10, that we need to have a realistic view of the human heart. And I'm not talking about the pump that goes swish, swish, swish. I'm talking about that part of you that is the thinker, the intellect, the emotions, the ability to make decisions, your motivator, your conscience. It's the immaterial part of you. What does it say in verse 9 of chapter 17? It says the human heart is the most deceitful of all things, and it's desperately wicked. Another translation says completely incurable. Who can really know how bad it is? We, this is not nice to say, it is, we are rotten to the core. But that's true. Again, it's not the organ that pumps your blood. It is the real you that lives behind your eyes, as we told our children about the soul. It is the immaterial part of us. And God says we need to see it as He sees it. It is most deceitful. You know, our biggest lies start with lying to ourselves, and then we move on to lying to others. And the lies that we tell ourselves sound very much like, I can get away with this, or it won't hurt me, or no one will know, or I'll just do it once. And there's probably a whole bunch that you could think of that go very much with those things that I just mentioned. We exaggerate, we deny, we blame others, we excuse, we deceive, we tell half-truths, don't we? And while we commonly say children are innocent, it's pretty likely we began lying to our parents or to one another when we were very young. Sin has affected every part of our personhood, and it kicks into gear the moment we're born. And what lies has the world foisted upon everyone? lies like there is no God, man is basically good. He needs a better environment or a better education. He needs the equality of outcomes, or our country's leaders have our best interest in mind for our society. Or sin is injustices in society against others, and we don't need a savior, and there's no afterlife. And again, the list could go on and on of lies that we've been fed. Jeremiah 17:10 is a contrast with the question in verse 9, who really knows how bad the heart really is? Well, God says, I know. I, Yahweh, search all the hearts and I examine all the secret motives. No CT or MRI scan can see the soul. It may see your brain, but not your mind, not your motive, not your conscience. God doesn't need a scanner to see what's going on inside our souls. Why do we have problems today? It is the human heart, the core answer. We are sinners and we do sinful things. We are proud and deceitful. All you have to do is trace human history in your own and your own life. Powerful world leaders, the common denominator often is pride and deceit. 99% of the time, and that's kind of an unscientific guess, I realize that, but I think if we looked at history, we'd see exactly that. God says in verse 10b, I give to all people their due rewards according to their actions, what their actions deserve. You know, justice is what people are crying out for today. I'm not sure they really would want that from God. No one has a ghost of a chance of getting anything but God's judgment and condemnation apart from his grace and mercy in sending Jesus to be our substitute. He took our place. He received God's wrath for our sin. And God then is able to forgive us, give us what we don't deserve, the forgiveness and eternal life based on his grace, instead of condemnation and banished from his presence forever. We simply can accept his gift by trusting what he said that he's done for us, that Jesus died to take our sin away. So let's summarize and apply some things. We need to, first of all, make a daily personal commitment to trust God, Jeremiah 16:19. We need to realize that there are consequences to our choices. Are we going to be a bush or a tree? We need to have a realistic of the sense of the human heart, Jeremiah 17:9-10. You know, God is the master illustrator, isn't he? He gives us these pictures of this scrub bush or a fruitful tree. You know, people desire option number two, but they live like option number one because they're trusting themselves and they're Xing out God out of their lives. Well rooted, grounded in the word, prepared for the future. You know, we look at life situations, like maybe the Kadesh Barnea situation, that are frightening circumstances all over the world almost constantly. What promises of God do you have firmly tucked away in your heart and mind that govern your life? Does God promise us a comfortable life of ease, prosperity, and physical healing? No, he doesn't. But what promises do we have? Let me give you a few. Hebrews 13, verses 5 and 6, God says, I will never fail you or abandon you. If this is true, then we can say what comes in verse 6. We can say, the Lord is my helper, so I will not fear. Can you say that? What can mere man do to me? That's the rest of the verse. What's the worst thing that can happen? Jail, torture, death for being a believer, loss of our stuff? Well, if that's true, heaven awaits us. It's much better there. You believe it? Is that your promise that you can claim and say, I'm not going to be afraid because God is with me? 2 Corinthians 12, verses 8 to 10. Three different times, Paul says, I beg the Lord to take the thorn in the flesh away. Each time he said, my grace is all you need. My power works best in weaknesses. So now I am glad to boast about my weakness so the power of Christ can work through me. That's why I take pleasure in my weaknesses, my insults, hardships, persecutions, and troubles that I suffer for Christ. For when I'm weak, then I'm strong. Did you see the if-then statement? We could say, if I'm hurting, then God's grace is sufficient. God's grace is all you need. But maybe we cry out, no, I need more, I need this, or I need that. And God says, my grace is all you need. You believe that? Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank Him for all He's done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. And His peace will guard your hearts and your minds as you live in Christ Jesus. Another if-then statement and a promise, right? Promise the shalom of God. Maybe it's freedom from the storm and everything is calm, or it may be your security in the midst of the storm. Can you thank God for that? You'll experience God's peace. Wow. Husbands, wives, parents, teens, children, single people, would you say one of these verses sometime each day together in the future? Would you write these verses on a card or a whiteboard or something? If you need to be rooted with these verses in the months ahead, here are some verses. Jeremiah 16:19, Lord, you are my strength and fortress, my refuge in the day of trouble. Another one, Psalm 62, verses 1 and 2. I will wait quietly for God. My victory comes from Him. He alone is my rock, my salvation, my fortress, where I will never be shaken. You know, we need reaction time when we are hit with an emotional blow. Maybe bad news comes about you or about a loved one or about a situation or a loss. And we need reaction time in our emotions and our thinking that doesn't always match up. Years ago, I had a toy gyroscope, and you know, you can bang that and it gets off balance and kind of wobbles around, but it eventually rights itself. And that's what this psalm is talking about. In that emotional blow, that reaction time may go, ooh, like this, but you know, we come back. God is my rock. God is my salvation. God is my fortress. I'm not going to be shaken, not for very long. Psalm 91, verses 1 and 2, those who live in the shelter of the Most High will find rest in the shadow of the Almighty. This I will declare about the Lord. He alone is my refuge, my place of safety. He's my God, and I trust Him. And then finally, again, you can make a longer list, but these, I would suggest that you say these to one another each day. Psalm 119, 114, you are my refuge and my shield. Your word is my source of hope. You know, if God's word is your source of hope, if you don't read the word or know the word, how is it going to be your hope? It won't be. The Holy Spirit needs to take the word of God and apply it to your life. And if you don't know it, you're not going to have what you need. It will not be your shield. It will not be your fortress, because God says, here is what you need to know. That idea of being rooted, grounded in the Word, will prepare us for the future. Please make these verses something that is part of your life, so that you can be grounded in the Word and prepared for whatever comes in the future. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, thank you for your Word, that it is our shield, that it is our sword, that it is the source of our hope. We thank you that we can have a personal relationship with you, who is our rock, our redeemer, our fortress, our refuge, our strength. Lord, thank you for the promise that your grace is all we need. Please help that to be true no matter what we face. In Jesus' name, amen. Truth remains that my God is the
So I was looking through that passage as Paul was preaching. I'm looking at how many different times we see the word trust show up in that chapter. And I was thinking back to, for some reason, perhaps God's leading to the words in the end of the book of Joshua. As he is before the nation of Israel, giving them and challenging them, he says in 24:14, "Now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness." And such an encouragement toward that really only comes what in we find ourselves doing those things as we purpose to trust him. And he really challenges them to choose this day, he says, who you will serve. And we face that choice each and every day and who we serve, to serve self and to follow after the things of the world, or to serve our Lord and Savior, to trust in him and follow the path that he has described as is indeed the best one. May our resolve be, as he says at the end of verse 15, "But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." May that be your resolve today. Thanks for watching. Thanks for being with us. God bless.